G'day, this is Matt Cornell from Cornell Engineers. Today I want to go through what we look for when we are interpreting contour plans that we've drawn on a house slab as a part of investigating slab heave, slab movement, subsidence, any one of those things. You might hear that name. So we've previously gone through a video on how we record levels and generate a set of contours. And I'll put the link down below to that video. It's on YouTube. This is part of the analysis now, and this is the sort of product that we might be looking at. This is a slab plan from someone's house and a set of contours. As you can see, we've recorded levels, reduced them to, in this case, and just about in every case, we put the lowest point as a zero and make every other level a level higher than that. Now, these are relative levels. So the zero compared to the 60 only means that the point here in the dining room is 60 millimeters higher than the zero point in bedroom one. It doesn't yet mean that bedroom one has sunk, and it doesn't yet mean that the dining room has lifted. That's the purpose of this analysis. This is what we're going to work out. So the sets of levels are taken, we reduce them to a zero point, we draw the contours in at 10 mil increments. If there's not as many levels, but not as many contours, then that's a good sign. So this particular plan, a different house, same process where we've put the lowest point is a zero and the highest point in this case is a 34, and we've drawn in contours at 10 mil increments. So you can see this contour plan, all these points on the slab were interpolating between the points that we actually measure to deduce that all these points along this line are at the equal height of 30 millimeters above the zero point. So this is the contour plan that a surveyor would generate, and it's the same idea. The lines on the plan are all at equal height, which allows you to get a nice visual representation of what points are at equal height and what parts are higher and lower than each other. Because this is a survey plan, there's also other information, where the boundary is, where the surfaces are on the site. But the points of equal line is the bit that's important to us. So starting with this plan, you can see again, we've got the lowest point is zero, the highest point on the slab is 60. And while we're interpreting these contours, we're trying to work out why this might be uneven. Part of our interview process, we try to work out when the movement might have occurred, and that forms part of our analysis as well. The only thing this contour plan tells us for sure is that the dining room slab now is 60 millimeters higher than the bedroom one front wall. That could well have been built like that. The house may well have been built with a 60 mil bump in the middle, and the front bedroom being 60 mil lower. If this was a concrete slab, it's possible the concreter poured it in this shape. So where some of the things we're analyzing is where there's damage. In this case, we'd expect there to be a lot of damage in this area where it goes from a fairly flat slab across the back part of the house, 50 to 38 is only 12 millimeters of movement, 38 to 60 is only 22 millimeters of movement, compared to at the front where there is a significant change in level from 0 to 40 in the space of one room. If there's a lot of damage where this part of the building has started to, or where there's a big change in the movement, then we deduce that this is a movement, this is a change in height that has occurred subsequent to the house being built. The next thing we're going to do in relation to reading these contours is work out what other influences might be affecting this house to cause this movement. Once we have assessed that there's damage in this area where the slab suddenly changes shape, that the area at the back seems to us fairly flat, if there's not a lot of damage in the back, then we're probably going to stop considering that and assess that part as stable. If it's been repaired previously, then all bets are off. It makes it really difficult to work out whether that part of the house is moving or has moved in the past if the damage has already been repaired. So we're assuming that the house was poured fairly flat in the first place, that maybe there was 10 to 15 to 20 millimeters of unevenness in the slab after it was built. Any unevenness subsequent to that has occurred as a result of movement. And the first indicator that maybe there's something going on is the fact that this is 40 millimeters at the back of the bedroom one, higher than the front. We're going to try and rule out or determine if this could be subsidence or dropping of the slab across this front area. So we're going to look at external influences. Is the ground naturally lower in this area? Are there trees in this area that could be sucking the moisture out of the ground? Is there fill in this area that's consolidated and immediately affect the house? If there's a set of board piers underneath this where there was fill placed, or the maximum amount of fill placed, if this was the lay of the block where there was more fill at the front than at the back, then perhaps it means that the piers weren't dug deep enough, or they weren't connected to the house properly and the house was still able to move. So reiterating, when we're assessing slab contour plans, the settle levels is just one part of the jigsaw. It's just one part of the puzzle. It's the assessment of the contours is based in relation to what other things could be going on. The other thing you'll notice is that this garage slab, we haven't taken any levels. We haven't drawn any contours in this garage slab area. That is because, and also the same applies for the laundry. In the laundry, we've taken a level. We haven't managed to get a contour in there because it's not at a 10 mil increment. Garages are typically poured, not always, but typically poured with fall towards the front door. Drawing contours in this area and measuring contours in this area doesn't give us any benefit. We don't know how much fall was placed in the garage slab when it was built, so we don't know how much it has moved. So to draw a set of contours through a garage at this stage, in this particular house, would probably just confuse things. So we haven't drawn any contours in the garage at all. Okay, let's move on to the next slab plan. Okay, so here we have a house, same thing, garage, which we refuse to draw any contours in. A lounge room, a patio area at the back, which is the same thing as the garage. We didn't measure contours on that area. We don't know how flat it was when it was built. We have ignored the effect of that slab. So no contours in the garage, no contours in the patio area. Let's just have a look and see what's going on here now. So I've got a 40 mil contour and the highest point of 42 in the wall, in near the wall of the kitchen. The lounge room is 20 millimeters lower than that highest point. And the lowest point, we put a zero contour or a zero measurement in here somewhere. So 40 millimeters higher in the kitchen than along this side of the house. So once again, the contours mean nothing by themselves. It may well be that the builder, when he poured the slab, poured the slab at a level. So now we're looking for other indicators that this is movement. We can assess and assume that the slab was poured flat, fairly flat when it was first built. But we're using these contours on the basis that yes, it was fairly flat. Wasn't necessarily, we're going to rule out that it wasn't just built this way by looking for where there's movement. And the areas where the contours are closest is where the slab is the steepest. So an area where there's hardly any contours is a fairly flat area. An area where the contour lines get rather close together is an indicator that there's unevenness in the slab. And as part of the assessment, we check that to AS2870 to see whether or not the slope on the floor is within the tolerable limits. So as part of the assessment now of these contours, we're going to look to see why this area might be higher than this area. If there was an influence, perhaps a reason for this to be higher, it might be that the soil is wetter under here compared to along this side of the house. It could be that there's a broken pipe in underneath the kitchen, that the water is finding its way to the middle of the house. and the soil here is a lot wetter than it is over here. The other thing is that it could be that there are trees in the vicinity of the laundry in the bedroom too, and they're drying the soil out. It could be that there is a natural slope on the ground prehistorically before the house was built, that this area was built on natural soil with only about 20 millimeters of movement in the slab, and this area was built on fill and has subsided slightly. So after the contours, once again, we go looking for reasons why this might be movement. We look for the damage to see where that's located, and then we assess whether or not there are outside influences that could be contributing to this shape, this measured shape of the slab. Let's have a look at another plan. This is our third one. I'll just make sure we haven't seen this one before. We have not. So in this case, we have a difference. We started with this one, that's why it seems familiar. 34 millimeters near the wall of bedroom two in the lounge room in here. 34 millimeters height difference between there and the lowest point of zero in the living room. Now, once again, we're going to go looking for reasons why the zero might be the lowest point on the slab and why the 34 might be the highest point on the slab. We'll be looking to see if there's trees perhaps sucking moisture out of the ground in this area. Maybe there's poor drainage along some of these sides. Maybe there's, and because of this ridge, we're going back to low out the back here, and maybe there's more trees out here. So again, these contours are just served as a tool to put together the puzzle to see what other influences might be contributing, where the damage has been located, and also what external influences are affecting this house slab. Okay, we've got one more plan for you. We've got a rafted area. We have twos and zeros, so the lowest point is one of these zeros. There's a couple of zeros along this side and a two, so notionally all fairly lower areas compared to the higher areas. The higher area we've got out the front as 42, 44. Look, over a house of this size, 0 to 40 millimeters, maybe the 60 millimeters is the clincher, but 0 to 40 millimeters isn't a great deal of movement in a house or unevenness in a house. It, over a long house like this one, it's probably going to be within tolerance, within the slope tolerance. If there is damage occurring, then again, we'll be looking to see why the ground might be lower in the area where it's lower, where the contours are lowest, and or why the floor might be higher in this area where the contours are higher. So we'd be looking for subsidence towards the back part of the house or consolidation of fill. And we might also be looking for soil moisture ingress in underneath the foundation at the front part of the house. Depending on the lie of the land, it might be that water is flowing towards the house in this area, getting under the slab and allowing the clay soils, if they are indeed clay soils, to expand and absorb that moisture and expand. Or this area might be particularly dry and be drying out, or it could have been fill and have been consolidating under the weight of the house that if the fill hadn't been placed appropriately and compacted properly. So that's why contour plans, they're useful. We use them a lot when assessing damage in houses, but they're only just one piece of the puzzle. They're only a snapshot, a point in time indication of the shape of the house. It does not tell you whether or not the house was poured perfectly flat, and we're making a lot of assumptions that the house was poured really, really flat and that this is movement. But we're only backing those assumptions up by then taking this information, looking for damage, looking for external influences around the outside of the house or underneath the house, and working that puzzle together to produce a set of recommendations on the best way to undo the external influences that might be affecting these houses. So thank you very much for joining us. This has been Matt Cornell from Cornell Engineers. I hope you've gotten or appreciated something out of the assessment of these contour plans that we generate, that engineers generate as part of an assessment of moving and cracking and subsiding and slab heave houses. Thank you very much for joining. Go and check out some of our other videos, and have a great day. See ya.